This is Truth Frequency Radio.
The wicked ones, obviously under heavy Masonic influence.
From the biggest little city in the world in the clear blue waters of Lake Tahoe, broadcasting from an undisclosed location in the Truckee River Valley on Truth Frequency Radio, this is the Awakening Liberty Show with Sean Carone. Here, if you're going my way, good Sunday afternoon to you all, and welcome to the Awakening Liberty Show right here on truthfrequencyradio.com, your protection from deception. I am your humble host, Sean Carone. We are live and worldwide, all across America, all around the world. The number to call in is 866-26-TRUTH. Again, that number is 866-268-7884. And joining me today is my co-host, Laurie Alexander of the Underground Resistance Network. How are you doing today, Laurie?
I'm doing fantastic, Sean. How are you?
Excellent. We're trying to beat the heat here in northern Nevada. It's been very hot. Boy, it's just draining.
Yeah, here too. We go from one extreme to the other here. Either it's raining every day or we're praying for the rain, and now we're praying for the rain.
Mm-hmm. We had plenty of rain this year. In fact, we had over 900 inches of snow up on the mountains this year, and we've got plenty of water. We are now apparently out of the drought, but now we're just in fire season, and we've had fires pop up all over the place.
I'm seeing that all over the place. I've got friends out in Arizona who are battling that same thing. Unbelievable weather out there. So much is going on with the weather patterns. It's just getting to be unmistakable.
Yeah.
I don't know about you in Nevada, but here in Chicago, we are getting pelted with the chemtrails.
Mm-hmm. It's been really clear here, actually, for the last week. And I saw this happen last summer as well. And I'm not really sure what's going on. Dane Wigington told me, they're spraying invisible stuff. They've changed their whole chemical situation. So who knows what's going on? It's really crazy. So. But, coming up here in just a few minutes, Gary Wayne, author of the Genesis 6 Conspiracy, How Secret Societies and the Descendants of Giants Plan to Enslave Humankind. He will be joining us again today for part 6 of our ongoing series, and we will be reviewing chapter 56 and 57, The Priory of Sion and the Knights Templar. This is going to be an interesting broadcast. First, I got to do my show disclaimer, and I got to give credit where credit is due, because Gary is actually going to recognize this because he inspired it. Today's broadcast contains truth. It may in whole or in part be intercepted, impeded, interrupted, stolen, stored, used, and misused by a broad set of intelligence agencies, hackers, professional thieves, government operatives, and creeps. The Awakening Liberty Show is now being carried live on IPMNation.com, iHeartRadio, TuneIn Network, and the K-Star Talk Radio Network. I want to welcome everybody who's listening to rebroadcasts on the Pyramid One Channel 2 Network, WLIR Australia, and of course, YouTube. We actually got up to 4,200 subscribers, Lori, and I heard you had some issues with YouTube recently.
They tried to shut us down last week, along with a lot of other channels. Eric Spitfire also had this this issue. We did an interview. We did a live broadcast probably about a month and a half ago. It was with Eric, myself, and Jeff Lehman, and we were talking about Sandy Hook. And apparently, the Honor Network and Lenny Posner struck again. Tried to shut us down for another 90-day suspension on our live stream, but we fought back. We have a person that specializes in this, and they filed an appeal, and we won. We got, not only have we got our ability to live stream put back, but we also got the video put back up. So yeah, we've been fighting a lot of censorship over there.
Oh, there's a lot going on YouTube. I just did a show with Christopher Boland, and obviously they've been pretty good to me. They leave me alone for the most part, but I don't monetize those shows because obviously 9/11 shows, they will just demonetize it right away, and oftentimes they will pull it. So I'm very careful about what I put on YouTube, and it probably, you know, I'm censored just to death over on YouTube, but it keeps growing a little bit, Laurie, so I'm happy about that.
So are we. So are we. We're up to almost 13,000 subs, and we're growing. And we just don't want to. We don't want to have that step backwards. We don't want to let them to. We don't want to let them deter our forward momentum that we've got going.
Yeah, I guess I'm just flying under the radar a little bit. You know, without further ado, I want to welcome Gary Wayne to the show. Gary, how you doing today?
I am doing excellent, and just so happy to be joining you and Laurie this afternoon. So. Thinking the conversation is going to be quite interesting for the audience today.
Absolutely, it will be. You know, I was going back through my files, Gary, and the first show we did was on January 1st, 2016. My, how time flies.
Yeah, it's gone by in a hurry. And so glad to be covering so much of my book on your show. And again, I think we're going to get into something really good today.
Absolutely. I'm really interested in these chapters. In fact, I spent a little bit of time reviewing. First of all, let everybody know about your book. It is The Genesis 6 Conspiracy. Fantastic read if you don't have it. Gary, let everybody know where they can get it.
Yeah, my book is available through most online bookstores. So Amazon.com, Amazon.ca, Amazon.uk, and Amazon, obviously, around the world, BarnesandNoble.com, Books A Million, so all the online bookstores. It's also available through your local bookstore. They probably don't have it on the shelf, but they can order it in for you if you want to support your local bookstore. They can order it through Bookmasters, and it's readily available. And you can also order a signed copy through my website at thegenesis6conspiracy.com. That's Genesis 6 with the number 6.com. And I can autograph it and personalize it any way that you want. And on that website, there is a generous excerpt out of all 98 chapters. So you'll get a really good feel for the book.
And 98 chapters of in-depth information. I have to say this every time we talk, Gary, is that this book sits right next to me every time I do a show. It's a quick reference guide. It is thoroughly and factually researched. In fact, the endnotes are absolutely incredible. Because you kind of put it together in a fact where it's like, look, you know, where's this information coming from? And you have all kinds of endnotes that, you know, justify everything that you're talking about.
Yeah, I think what happens too much in this type of genre is there's too much speculation and there's too much secrecy in terms of where the information comes from. So not only was I wanting to tell a complete narrative and in a way that I don't think anybody else has presented it before, but I also wanted to show where I got my research from so that people could check the veracity of the research and the accuracy of it and perhaps continue to dig deeper on it, because that's really what I'm trying to do, is get the information out there.
Yes, and just a real quick synopsis here of the book. Section 1, the Antediluvian Epoch. We've got In the Age of Great Heroes. We have Section 2, The Golden Age, The Descendants of Anak. The Terminal Generation, which is one of my favorite chapters, Gary, Rex Deus, Rendezvous with Destiny, Anatomy of a Global Conspiracy, which is exactly what we are involved in, The House of Dragon, Bloodlines of the Prehistoric Giants, which was the last show that we did, and The Gene of Isis, Bloodlines of the Fairies. It's just an amazing book, and if you do, I highly recommend you order the book, and when you sit down and read it, make sure you've got a dictionary, and make sure you have a concordance, and you have your Bible handy, because Gary actually goes back to the Bible in many different areas, and it's just a huge amount of information, Gary.
Well, thank you, and it is a large book, and people will have to read it as they can digest it, because there's so much information there. But even though it's a large book, each chapter is written as a mini story that leads into the next chapter, and will keep coming up as the book unfolds. So it makes it a little easier to go back and reread a chapter when that information comes up again and again, because it will, as I go through a 6,000-year connect-the-dots investigation into the House of Dragon, as I like to call the Giants.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And Laurie, you're you've studied a lot of this Genesis 6 stuff, talking about the Nephilim and what happened in Genesis 6. Obviously, the rebellion against our Creator, the Lord Almighty, and you've been down this path too.
Absolutely. I'm looking so forward to talking with Gary about this. A lot of questions. Yes, I've actually studied more on the Mirkavenian bloodlines and the bloodlines of the Illuminati. The Arcane Arcanium, the bloodlines of the Serpent. So yeah, very familiar with this.
Yes,
well, we're going to intersect with the Mirkavenian bloodlines today with what we're talking about. So.
Most definitely. So we're going to start with chapter 56, the Knights Templar. And I wanted to ask you this because I'm going to read the intro to that chapter, because as you do in many of the chapters, you refer to the Bible. I thought it's very interesting that you talk about 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, 9 through 12. The coming of the lawless one will be in accordance with the work of Satan, displayed in all kinds of counterfeit miracles, signs, and wonders, and in every sort of evil that deceives those who are perishing. They perish because they refuse to love the truth and to be saved. For this reason, God sends them a powerful delusion so that they will believe the lie, and so that all will be condemned who have not believed the truth and have delighted in wickedness. Again, that's 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 9 through 12. And you started off the Knights Templar chapter 56 with that verse, and I'm curious as to why you did that.
Well, because I'm really starting to lead into coming off of a quick overview of prophecy in the section before. The size of the deception and the organizational infrastructure that it takes to bring upon a deception that will deceive even the elect, if that were possible, it has to be significant. And I wanted to introduce the concept as we start to talk about it in detail in chapter 56 as to what is all at play. And this is sort of an introduction to the modern organization at a starting point where I thought I could go both forwards and backwards with, because the Templars are such a important cross-section of modern history and the last 2,000 years of this 6,000-year conspiracy, because it is the formalization of a secret society that is so immense and so powerful that when it falls, it literally takes, let's say, 6 major organizations of secret societies to replace them, and literally hundreds and hundreds of ones underneath to do what the Templars were established to do. And so you can imagine with all of that, that the size of this level of deception and planning is as old as Adam itself, but particularly in the last 2,000 years, it has really sort of come to fruition to shape itself for the end time.
So who were the Knights Templar? I mean, we have an awful lot of probably revisionist history that paints them in a very, very good light as the protectors of the realm and protectors of Christians and protecting the pilgrims, the Christian pilgrims. But that's not really the case. So let's talk about who the Knights Templar really were.
Yeah, and just so that people know that another initiatory order within Catholicism was already established at the time of the formation of the Templars to protect the pilgrims. So this is a ruse. And that the typical sort of understanding of who these knights were is that they were poor, impoverished monks and of no distinct bloodlines or anything else. And that's sort of how they come across to form this military knight order within the Catholic Church. But that's not what happened. And it is so far from the truth that, they've been very active to paint a different story to keep sort of under the radar as to what they're really trying to do. So when we talk about the Knights Templar, these are the most powerful families of France and Southwest France in particular, and even into Northwest Spain, into the area of Septimania and, the home of the Basques and so many other sort of rebellious groups that come out of this area. So these are the sons and kings and princesses of Europe. And so some of these individuals are very, very powerful, and they start very, very powerful family lines because they're coming out of very powerful bloodlines. And so, you know, for example, Godfrey de Bouillon, who is one of the most significant founders of the Knights Templar, he's a descendant of Dagobert of the Merovingian bloodline. And, of course, he's the first Grand Master. So instantly, things become a little bit overturned from the preconceived notion just with starting with Godfrey de Bouillon. And if you look at another one, let's say Andre Montabard, for example, I mean, he's the uncle of Saint Bernard, who is the second most powerful individual in Catholicism, who's going to write a letter in support of the Knights Order in 1128 at the Council of Troyes. So there's an interconnection between the powerful elite and the Gnostic moles that are already in the Catholic Church. You have names like Champagne, and you have names like the Folk of Anjou. And as you get into the Priory of Sion records, you're also going to get Henry St. Clair or part of the St. Clair clan. And these are the formation of the Knights from the beginning, 9 in the standard tradition, 11 in the secret society tradition that includes the St. Clairs, and mostly coming out of, I guess, the Priory of Sion and Masonic records as you get into those types of names. So that's a sort of a quint. Sort of, let's not look at this as some sort of insignificant play by some poor knights over in Jerusalem.
Now, the Priory of Sion, now they actually, and we're going to talk about that in the next hour, because they are actually centered in all of this craziness and this occultism. But the Priory of Sion, actually, they were the ones that created the Knights Templar?
Yes, partially. So actually the Priory of Sion is created at the same time as the Knights Templar. It will be the inner organization underneath that is working, that's guiding the Knights Templar. And so this is a coming together of several different groups. So you have people like the most powerful Freemasons or the Masonic Order of the ancient Masonic Adepts of Europe coming together from the royal bloodlines who descend back to the Essenes, which is another rabbit hole, to establish the Knights of the Temple of Sion. And they're coming together with the Essenes, and they're coming together with the Johannite brothers. They're coming together with the followers of Ormus out of Alexandria and the Gnostics there, the Mandaeans, the Sabians. And they're, you know, also the Calabrian monks, which is another mystical order within the Catholic Church. So this is a coming together of many, many groups to form two orders. One that's on the surface, which is the Knights Templar, and the guiding arm, which is the Priory of Sion, which is formed from people that go back into secret societies into prehistory. So hopefully I'm not confusing people with that nuance. But it's important to understand that the Priory of Sion leaves the Knights Templar in 1188 at what is known as the cutting of the elm in a Gnostic sort of ceremony at Geezer's castle. And the reason why they split away is because they believe that the Knights Templar have lost their way and they're not fulfilling the original agenda that the Priory of Sion had designated them to do. And this is why you don't see Grand Masters in the Priory of Sion list that was produced, even though a lot of people like to try and debunk it, only does not go back beyond 1188. So if you want the Grand Masters of the Priory of Sion before 1188, you go to the Knights Templar list, because there were one group before that.
And you mentioned the agenda, what they were originally created to do. What was that, so that everybody understands?
Yeah, so this is an organization that's working within the church. So it's multifaceted. So it's mystics and Gnostics within the church, and they're working undercover with organizations that would be like a monastic order that would sort of date back to the Essenes, because again, they're all interconnected here. And so those would be like the Cistercians and the Benedictine monks that St. Bernard comes out of, and organizations like the Calabrian monks, and which basically promoted the Pythagorean mystery school and seven sacred sciences view of how to view the world and the Bible, and the Augustines, just as some quick examples. So those are the ones that are within the church, and they're going to try and convert the church over to a religion that is not Christian anymore. That's the long-term play. And after the fall of the Knights Templar, it's going to be replaced by the Jesuits in about 1500s. And again, they also interpret the Bible through the seven sacred sciences.
Right.
But I'm going down a rabbit trail. The other agenda is not only are they preparing for the universal religion of the end time that's going to be centered in Rome, but what they're also trying to do is set up and be at the cutting edge of exploratory missions, which the Jesuits will take over afterwards, to start developing this one world government that is the Templar dream. So this new Atlantis that is talking about this new age is actually part of the dream that comes out of the organization of the Templars to create the old Atlantis of the Antediluvian epoch.
And Laurie, you were mentioning the Jesuits as we talked earlier. I'm sure you've got some questions when it comes to that. Would the Jesuits be considered the modern day Knights Templar?
Are you talking to me, Sean?
Yes. And I know Laurie's got some questions about this.
Yeah, no, I wouldn't look at them that way, because the Templars were disassembled into a number of groups, as I mentioned earlier, so that all of that wasn't going to be centered. What the Jesuits were designed to do was to continue to gain control and continue to work Gnosticism within the Catholic Church, to take over the education part so that they can control the thought process of Catholics coming through and going into seminary schools. And what they're also trying to do is prepare the world and take over the church through what they're trying to do, and get one of their Jesuit black popes on the throne of the Vatican so that they can usher in the end time through the universal church that's going to be centered in Rome, but on a timetable that's their timetable as opposed to God's timetable.
Right. Go ahead, Laurie.
No, a lot of people, when they think of the Knights Templar, they think of Dan Brown's movie.
The Da Vinci Code.
Yes.
I got cut off. They think of Dan Brown's movie, The Da Vinci Code. And they think of, the keepers of the Holy Grail. They think of, the bloodline, how they're trying to possibly insinuate that Christ and Mary Magdalene, moved on and, had a baby and, this whole thing, and the keepers of the bloodline. And you mentioned about how they're trying to set up for the end times. In my research, I've done a lot on the Merovingian, and I too have, just my personal opinion, that I believe the Antichrist will come from that bloodline. Do you think that that's what they're doing? Is they're setting up for for the Antichrist to take his throne over the new world religion and the world government?
Absolutely. They're going to try, and whether or not they're successful or not, but their plan is to present their Antichrist, their Christ, or their false Christ through the bloodlines that they've been protecting through the Templars. The Templars were called the keepers of the message and the protectors of the bloodline and protectors of the Grail. And, the Templars were, came together in about 1090, formalized in 1099, became by Papal Bull 1128 at the Council of Troyes by St. Bernard, advocating for them. But they show up in Grail stories, in King Arthur stories. They're all dressed like Templars. So they're dressed before they're even formed. And if people don't think that there's a connection here with the bloodlines and the Templars showing up, they're mistaken, because it was these families, these Masonic families and bloodlines that I talked about that formed the Knights Templar, and the Knights Templar who funded the writing of the Grail stories in the Middle Ages. And the Grail story is encoded with their belief system, their genealogies, and their history. It is filled with allegory and symbolism that the adepts and the initiated understand, because that's how they keep their, I guess, history alive in plain sight. But yet they also know that people are usually too distracted or don't pay attention and don't really understand what the true story is being said there. So if you want to know about the bloodlines of Mary Magdalene, as they believe it, and Jesus and Jesus surviving the cross, it's encoded in the Grail.
And that's really interesting. And I think it's really important that we talk about Dan Brown, the Da Vinci Code, and a lot of this revisionist history that is being painted as a picture of obviously non-nefarious agendas. Yet they keep referring back to this this ancient mystic Babylon religion. I think it's really important that people understand that there is a huge revisionism of history in order to deceive us all. We're going into a break here. When we come back, we're going to talk more about this. We're going to talk about the Freemasons. We're going to talk about the Knights Templar, and we're going to talk about their occultist agenda, because so many people were involved in this occult. And I would venture to say it's the Babylon mystery religion. But when we come back, the Awakening Liberty Show with my guest, Gary Wayne, will be right back, along with my co-host, Laurie Alexander. Stay tuned.
I'll bust it one time. Truth and liberty. Fighting the new world order and the tyranny. The Awakening Liberty Show with Sean Caron.
And welcome back. Segment 2 of the Awakening Liberty Show right here on truthfrequencyradio.com. Your protection from deception all across the world, all across America. The number to call in is 866-26-TRUTH. Again, that number is 866-268-7884. I want to send a big shout out to everybody who is in the chat room. My wife, Beth. We've got Charles Calvo, Charlie, Jacob, Lori, Louis Taw, Marvin Dank, Melissa Taylor, Rockin' Rio 7, Simon Wilkins, TFR Wookie, Zella Zapitsky. Thank you for joining me on this Sunday afternoon. The days just seem to blend into each other. I don't know. Maybe it's just a senior moment, but that's what we're doing here on the radio today. We're talking about Gary Wayne's book, The Genesis 6 Conspiracy, How Secret Societies and the Descendants of Giants Plan to Enslave Humankind. An absolutely fabulous read. I highly suggest that you get it if you are into the history of what's going on and into connecting the dots as to what's going on in the world today with the rise of an Antichrist, with the New World Order, this one world religion, that everything is being set up. I highly recommend you check out this book because it's a fabulous read. Gary, I loved it. And before the break, we were talking about Dan Brown, the Da Vinci Code, and much of the revisionist history that we see coming out there. It's crazy. I mean, would you say that Dan Brown with the Da Vinci Code, the book and the ones that followed, was that, I mean, are they trying to program people into believing this whole aspect of Mary Magdalene and Jesus Christ having sex and bearing children?
Yeah, one of the things that these groups do on all fronts, so it doesn't matter whether or not it's on the superhero phenomena that you see in movies or in science fiction, and everything that they do is they try and prepare us and brainwash us to accept more easily what's going to happen. So Dan Brown's story is a fiction, and he claims it to be a fiction, and it is fiction to a certain degree, but it's based on what they believe. And he has so much occultic inside information that it that is so accurate. Like, he obviously either has a good source for occultism and their belief system, or he is one. And I know an occultic writer named Sylvia Brown says the same type of thing. The point of the matter is, though, is what he's doing within his fictional story is telling us what they believe. And what they believe is that Mary Magdalene met Jesus after the crucifixion because Joseph of Arimathea takes Jesus down from the cross before he's before he dies. And in fact, even in the New Testament, it talks about Pontius Pilate being surprised that, you know, Jesus would be dead that quickly, and they sort of point to that. So they nurse him back to health, and also they claim that Joseph of Arimathea is an Essene as well, which is part of the group that I was talking about, who nurses them Jesus to help and sort of contrives this to take him down before he dies. And he meets up with Mary, and he produces children with Mary Magdalene, as the story goes, with Josephes being the one that carries on what they call the Davidum, which is like a Caesar title. And he is the heir of this bloodline as a direct descendant of Jesus. And this is the bloodline that marries in at Joseph of Arimathea takes over to England with him and the marries into the Celtic kingships and the Pendragons that are going to produce the King Arthur kingship eventually, in one of the two main lines coming out of the Camelot dynasties. And this bloodline crosses over to the Merovingian bloodline with Aminadabad of the Merovingians, who is going to marry Ergen, and will bring that bloodline to the Merovingians, which then will pass down to Dagobert, which will pass down to Godfrey de Bouillon. So when I was talking earlier about these genealogies and what they're talking about, it is encoded in their literature and its preparation. You've got the King Arthur tales and the Grail tales, and you've got this Da Vinci Code, just as one quick example.
Mm-hmm. Laurie?
Yes. Are you, shoot, am I still breaking?
You're breaking up a little bit, but you're okay. We can hear you. I think we might have lost her. Are you still there? I think we lost Laurie. Well, yeah, that's live radio for you.
Yeah. And just so people know how Ergen goes back, Ergen is the daughter of King Lucius, which is the son of King Cole, which goes back to a marriage between Anna and Joshua of the Alan clan. And Joshua is thought to be Josephes as a different name. And of course, the Alan is another interesting bloodline that brings in Nephilim bloodlines. And what's going on here, it's a conversion of the Nephilim bloodlines and a conversion of the alleged Jesus bloodlines to create a pedigree for the Antichrist that Laurie was talking about, and believing that they will present the Antichrist in the end time, which I also agree with.
Gotcha. And Laurie's still on my Skype call board. Are you there, Laurie?
I am. I'm back. I'm sorry about that.
Yeah, that's okay. I wanted to give you a chance to come in here and talk a little bit of, and ask Gary some questions about this whole thing, especially regarding the revisionist history.
Absolutely. You know, I have to ask you something, Gary. There's an interesting thing I found. I did 4 years of research on the Merovingian bloodline. The whole, Dan Brown actually got me started on it a number of years ago. But I ran across something in my research, and I want to ask you about it regarding, it kind of goes along with Revelation 13 with the beast rising out of the sea, and I want to ask you about this. The term Merovingian is said to derive from the Merovi, who was a king of the Franks from 447 to 458 AD. Despite his claims, the Merovingian Franks were sired by Jesus Christ and Mary Magdalene, and therefore divine. The legend of King Merovingi conceals the true origins of the Merovingian race in remote antiquity. According to the legend, Merovingi had two fathers, King Clodion and a, quote, strange beast of the sea. What do you think about that?
Yeah, and I think when you talk about the beast, I mean, it is a relationship with Antichrist. I mean, these are spiritual beasts, and they deny God, they slander God. In the spirit of the Antichrist chapter, I'll talk a little bit more about that. Now, this beast that they're talking about is also known in other legends and writings as the Quinitar, which is very, very similar to the Minotaur. And again, that sort of is an allegory back to the bull cult. But it's a larger allegory that there is two bloodlines being intermixed here. One is from Jesus and Mary Magdalene, and also they have direct David bloodlines in there as well through another line. They also have King Saul's bloodline in there, but those aren't from the sea. Those are Israelite ones, as they allege that they have married in. But the one from the sea is generally known as the Gentiles, and the Gentiles are the ones that are basically the ones that are intermixing with the giants of old and creating these beast hybrids, right? So this is an allegory, I believe, and I write about it in my book, that is an allegory of a secret bloodline that is, the bloodlines go back to the original kings of France as well, and back to Scythia in the Troy area. And it's an allegory for Nephilim bloodlines.
It's a tangled web that they have weaved, regardless. To sum up things about the Knights Templar, I find it very interesting, obviously, the revisionist history stating that the Knights Templar were this great organization that protected the Christians. But yet Rome had already charged another order. I guess it was the Knights of St. John who were responsible for the protection of the pilgrims. Talk a little bit about the Knights of St. John.
Well, it's an initiatory order as well, and it survives today, and it is known as the Knights of Malta. They just had another specific goal for it. So they had this Christian sort of veneer to them, but they worship many gods underneath, just as the Templars did in their true religion, and mostly Cathars and Gnostics. And they wore the Black Cross white cross as opposed to the Red Cross. It's the Teutonic Order that would have donned the Black Cross. And so this is the order that has been working sort of on its own and has influenced European politics significantly, that North Americans aren't maybe all that well aware of, but particularly French and British politics have been very, very influential on. And also, this is the order that's quite interesting, interestingly enough, at least to me, that Pope Francis just recently took complete charge over to utilize more for his own specific goals. So there seems to be a little bit of infighting and power control there, just as Pope Francis has put in another Jesuit to help with changing doctrine and replace the one from Benedictine. So does that sort of give you a quick overview of the Knights of St. John or the Knights of Malta?
Yes, it does. And Laurie, would you add anything to that?
No, I'm sitting here. Sorry, I'm in the chat room. No, I mean, it's absolutely correct. I mean, he's actually, I apologize, I have not read your book yet, but everything that, you know, is coming here is just kind of validation of everything that I found. Also, it's going to be interesting to see how this carries out.
Yeah, and many of the Knights Templar actually fled after 1307 into the Knights of St. John because it's a sister organization. Just as many of those knights fled to England, especially with the knowledge and the wealth that they had protected, and certainly the Catholics and the French king did not get that because that's one of the things that they were after. But it fled to Scotland under the protection of King Bruce because he was excommunicated at that time, not, you know, subject to the oversight of the Catholic Church because he had killed his rival in a Catholic church to become king. And he provided protection along with, guess who? The St. Clairs, or the St. Clair family, mm-hmm. who converts the Templars from the Templar organization, because they can't really call them that anymore, but now converts them to Freemasonry, and that's where that route sort of starts up. And what's interesting about this also is King Bruce also creates a special order that he combines with another order of Scottish order that was created at the time of their intersection with the Knights Templars a couple hundred years before that. But this is the Rosy Cross Order that is being especially established to protect the king in Scotland at that time. And another interesting thing about all of that in terms of a reference is that, you know, when you get into Masonic history, what they talk about is that, you know, the head of the order of this Masonic organization that we're talking about that moves to create the Templar orders, they say that their history and their order has always been in Palestine at a place called the Abbey Notre Dame de Sion. And what's interesting about that is it's a very small, little insignificant chapel where Godfrey was crowned, but turned down the King of Jerusalem title, but was crowned with the Holy Sepulchre title. But in 1118, his brother Baudouin is crowned King of Jerusalem in this small little temple as well. And priory means a small temple. And this is at the Rock of Zion in Zion. So you want to know where the Priory of Sion name comes from? Comes from that original founding that I talked about at this ritual and at their small headquarters that was located in Jerusalem on the Rock of Zion. And Sion is just the French word for Zion as it comes out of Latin. So the transliteration there.
Yeah, thanks for clearing that up, because so we hear so much about Zionism and Zion and then Sion. The words are interchangeable.
Yes, exactly. It's just the different, you know, how the different languages would spell it or pronounce it. So, and just as in Spanish, it would be Sion as well. So
we hear the Knights Templar, they were this great organization that were there to protect Christians, and they were in fact Christians, and they were fighting to maintain the safety of people who were beginning to practice Christianity, who had come to God, who had come to know the Lord. Yet these people were really not Christians. They were mystics. Isn't that the case?
They're all mystics and Gnostics and part of secret societies. In fact, these monks, there was a collection of monks, let's say, like two of them would have been Roselle and Gondomir, which were Benedictine and Cistercian monks. Those would have been sort of the Gnostic sort of priesthood involved in there. And then these other families were royal bloodlines who were Gnostics and descendants of the Essenes, or the princes of Jerusalem, as they like to call themselves, and practicing the Cathar religion, or the sister Albigensian religion that was also active in that same area.
And does this all go back to the Babylon mystery religion?
Well, I mean, when they're talking about creating from this time on a universal religion, this is the Babylon religion. I mean, Babel is the religion that these groups believe in, because it's always worked with in tandem and in partnership with the Nephilim bloodlines as being the kings and the sovereigns and the priests of this universal religion. And it restarts at Babel with King Nimrod and reestablishing the antediluvian religion of Enoch that Hermes finds, because Nimrod partners with Hermes according to Masonic records, and Nimrod becomes the first Grand Master of Freemasonry or Masonry after the flood, writing a new constitution and building Babel and Babel City as its first manifestation of the seven sacred sciences that you and I talked about very early on in our shows, and the technology that went with it. But they instituted this Babel religion that is the allegory for the end time religion. And this is the religion that worships fallen angels and polytheism, or the pantheon, as most people would understand it.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned Enoch, and for those of you who don't know, you were talking about Enoch the Evil, because in fact there were two Enochs, correct?
Correct. There's the Enoch, son of Jared, on the Seth line, who's the one who walked with God and was taken to heaven in a rapture-type event, to be with God, and maybe one of the ones who come back in the end time. We don't know, because there's three possibilities here for the two witnesses, although I think all three will come back with just different roles. And then there's Enoch, son of Cain, and people don't tend to realize that. And in fact, there's two Lamechs in both genealogies of Seth and Cain, and many of the names are very, very similar, so it's easy to conflate the names and what each of these individuals did. But understand that Freemasonry and the Templars believe that Enoch was the one who created their original Masonic organization and the original sun-worshipping bull cult of the antediluvian epoch. And just as Lamech, Nama, Jabal, and Tubal-Cain are significant patriarchs in their belief system, and which is why they're listed in the Genesis account, because you're only listed in the Bible for one of two reasons, for important things you did or horrible things you did. And they were part of developing these seven sacred sciences that develop the technology and the religions that then partnered with the fallen angels to create the Nephilim in the sixth generation to usurp the antediluvian world. And they've been trying to recreate that rebellion ever since, which is what's going to happen in the end time again.
I do. I want to say something here. You mentioned you mentioned a couple of things I want to address. You mentioned Tubal-Cain, and those that have done any research on the Freemasons know that Tubal-Cain plays a significant role in modern day Freemasonry. And you also mentioned the sciences. I don't know if people realize that the Knights Templar. I mean, going back even into it was created in 1188. If you just look at the Knights Templar. The numbers alone, the 11, the 88, the significance of Friday the 13th also has a Knights Templar meaning behind it. But some of the Grand Masters were some of our scientists, Da Vinci, Isaac Newton, and even goes up to far as Stephen Hawking. Stephen Hawking is now holding the seat that Isaac Newton held at Cambridge. So these are all, you can pretty much... right from the early Templars right up to modern day, correct?
Right, and those are more prior Sion Grandmasters that you were listing as opposed to the Knights Templar, because they had separate Grandmasters up to 1307, and then the Templars disappear. But those Grandmasters that you're mentioning that are scientists, they continue after, of course, the fall of the Knights Templar. Just in case there's anybody's looking for any inconsistencies in what we're saying, because we're on the same page here. And so what's interesting, and just as a quick bridge here, so Enoch develops the seven sacred sciences to do a number of things. One is to lead people away from God. And that's why there's this new religion and development of the sciences. The second thing is to not give God credit for anything. And the third thing is to slander God in any way that they can. And the fourth thing is to honor their own pantheon of gods of the fallen angels that makes up the pantheon of all polytheism around the world. Same gods, just different names. And so if you move that forward, just to finish, the Royal Society is created in about 1640s, but was formalized again after in about 1660. It's created by Rosicrucians and Freemasons to do those four things that I just mentioned. And that controls science today, controls science outside of the church, controls the education, and plus they have the Jesuits on the inside to do the same thing. And you see the fruit of those four points manifested throughout science. And in particularly, it's the evolution one that is really designed to lead people away from God.
And I would say that it seems not only that they want to discredit God, they want to discredit the special nature of humanity and his creation, but obviously they're also trying to destroy what Christ did on the cross and the salvation that is afforded to us with what he did. And I think that's the other agenda, correct?
Absolutely it is. And from their belief system, it's a dualist belief system, right? It's a good versus evil. And they're in equal balance, as in yin and yang, or as in the good force and the bad force. I mean, there's so many different allegories for it. And how they rationalize that coming forward is their god, Lucifer, or as it goes back to Hebrew, Hallel, or the great architect of the universe, as they will also call him, is the equal of our god, whom they call Adonai. And they say that this has always been and always will be in their belief system, and that what they're trying to do with the rebellion is just as what happens in Star Wars is they want to have their own realm away from the evil God of the Bible to live the way that they want.
Lori?
That's absolutely true. And we see this on so many levels. You know, we have, science completely, evolution. I mean, there's the perfect example of evolution leading people away from the belief of God, and that I think is the number one mission for them, is just to push for the sciences. They do it in the schools. They do the indoctrination, really hard with the schools. And doing the research, it's come to the realization that they are trying to take away from what happened. Jesus' final words, it is finished. And they're trying to say that it's not finished, and they're trying to continue the story where the story did end.
Yeah, because they believe that they can still win, or at least win their own realm. The demons and the fallen angels, they know it's over. I mean, Jesus went to them after saying it was finished while he was still in the grave to tell them it's over. Like, the fate is sealed and the resurrection has happened. But for the people, the humans, they continue to deceive them so that they will rebel. And so as many as possible will be deceived, and they will continue to add to the lie to lead as many people as possible away. But I don't believe that the fallen angels believe that they, have a chance to win. They never knew. They knew they could never win. They were made by God. They know how powerful he is. They were hoping for a separate realm. But that's obviously not going to happen, as prophecy says otherwise, that they're going to burn in the lake of fire. So, but they use humans to slander God, right? And that's why Antichrist is such an arrogant individual, and he's going to say unheard of things. He will say things that even Nimrod probably didn't say, if that were possible, and essentially it is, because the angels and the demons know how powerful God is. They will not slander God because they're afraid of the power of God.
Yeah, I guess their whole goal is to turn as many souls away from God as they possibly can. And I guess if they do that, if they are successful in some way, they would win. But obviously, Jesus Christ, 3 days dead in the ground, he went to them in the abyss and said, it is done. To sum the Knights Templar up, and this is very interesting, I'm going to read a passage from the book. The objective of the secret society, and we're talking about the Order of Sion here, has been to nurture and protect these alleged bloodlines of Jesus, those few members of the Merovingian bloodline who had survived into our age. I guess you were talking about Stephen Sora here, believes that the Knights Templar were organized to conceal the true motives of the Order of Sion, for their true motive was to reestablish the kingship of Jerusalem with French bloodlines descending from Jesus and Mary Magdalene. The Templars were therefore known as the guardian princes of the royal secret, and I can't help but wonder if it's not a really a royal secret, it's really a big royal lie.
Yeah, I think, well, certainly the bloodlines of Jesus and Mary Magdalene is a lie. But they need to create the deception. They need to keep as high a pedigree alive in their genealogies to deceive the people of the end time, because they're uniting all of these bloodlines, right? So it can't be ennobled by any other match. And that is their goal. But obviously, that aspect is false. And for all we know, the bloodlines that they've chronicled from the Mist of Times may be forged as well. But they say they have these genealogies and they're going to present them in the end time. And that's why, Paul talked to us about...
Hold on, Gary. We're going to go into a break here. When we come back, we're going to talk about what Paul said. So everybody stay tuned. My guest Gary Wayne and my co-host Laurie Alexander will be right back on the Awakening Liberty Show. Stay tuned.
I'm Michael Toscano.
You must unite what has been set aside.
We are TFR.
Truth Frequency Radio.
Hi, everyone. This is Sean from the Awakening Liberty Show.
Are you and your family prepared for an emergency? Have you ever thought about investing in food and water storage? Well, if you have, I urge you to check out my one-stop prepper shop. AwakeningLibertyStore.com carries the full line of Legacy Premium, non-GMO, made-in-USA emergency food storage and survival gear. Folks, I've tried them all, and Legacy Premium is the best I've found. Boasting the lowest cost per pound, the lowest cost per calorie, and the largest serving size in the industry, Legacy Premium is simply the best. Not to mention it was voted best tasting in blind taste tests, and I personally concur. Shop AwakeningLibertyStore.com and use coupon code PATRIOT for a special listener discount, or call me personally at 775-276-4046. Once again, AwakeningLibertyStore.com.
And welcome back, hour number two of the Awakening Liberty Show, right here on truthfrequencyradio.com, all across America, all around the world. The number to call in is 866-268-7884, or simply 866-26-TRUTH. My guest today is Gary Wayne, and we'll be getting back to him in just a minute. But first of all, I want to take a second to thank everybody who helps make this show possible. I mean, it's purely listener supported. And if you are so inclined to donate to the cause of truth and to my efforts, along with all of the guests that I bring to you, there are multiple ways of supporting the show. There is a donate button at AwakeningLibertyShow.com. AwakeningLibertyShow.com. You can stop by and check out my calendar of upcoming guests. You can also hit the donate button as well. You can also subscribe to Truth Frequency Radio. If you go under my banner, 50% of it goes to help me, the host, and 50% of it helps the network as well. And my favorite is make a purchase at my one-stop prepper shop. You just heard the ad for Awakening Liberty Store. Again, AwakeningLibertyStore.com. I have the full line of Legacy Premium, non-GMO, made-in-USA emergency food storage, survival gear, survival power. We've got geodesic dome greenhouses. We've got all kinds of stuff. So stop by AwakeningLibertyStore.com, and you can still use coupon code MAYDAY and get 15% off your entire order. I understand that things are tight right now, but any donation is greatly appreciated. I'd like to thank Brian and Angela Pryor, Paul Roll, Alex Asta, Dominic Properties, Phil Restino, Angela Cope over on Patreon, all the Awakening Liberty Store customers, anonymous donors, DCWebDesigns.net, FutureDanger.com, Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube subscribers and viewers. Thank you so much. And I also want to thank my family. Obviously, my wife puts up with me, and I do this every weekend doing the show, and she is very supportive of all of that. Again, my co-host today is Laurie Alexander from the Underground Resistance Network. Say hello, Laurie.
Hello, everybody. Welcome for joining us.
It's awesome to have you here again, and it's awesome to be talking with Gary. And before the break, Gary, we were talking about, obviously, who this organization was. And we, to sum this all up, the Knights Templar, from revisionist history, are not who we were told they were. They were, in fact, Babylonian mystics. They were Gnostics. They were not a sect of Christian the religion. In fact, they were fighting against it. And I find it interesting that when we start talking about the Priory of Sion, and I wanted to ask you this, because there's a lot that is said about the protocols of the Elders of Sion. Is that a hoax, or is that real?
Well, I think these are one of the organizations of that's very high up, that's representative of the 13 families, of the Western families, and sort of that descendants of these Masons that we were talking about who formed the Knights Templar. Because, I mean, these documents are written, over 100 years ago, and are said to be even older than that. And yet what they said they were going to do, if somebody were to read it, is happening today. They said they were going to do it, right? So I think this is part of the same group. There's no doubt about it.
Very interesting. The other thing I wanted to get into before we get into the Priory is this group of people that was a Muslim sect called the Assassins. Can we talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, we can. And just before the break, though, I just wanted to finish off what I was just going to say.
Oh, that's right, Paul.
Was saying about the genealogies, and what basically said in 1 Timothy 3, as I recall, is advising followers not to teach false doctrines, which is the Masons will convert as false gnosis, because they like that word gnosis and everything, which is knowledge, and not to devote themselves to myths and endless genealogy. So this is connecting the two together, that the people who keep these genealogies within the religions and the royalty and the bloodlines are the ones that are going to have been around from the ancient times and continue to move forward right now. So now, what was the question that you wanted me to answer?
I was curious, when we start talking about, before we get into the Priory, I want to talk about the Watchers, of this guardian, this ancient knowledge, but the Assassins were derived from
the Assassins.
The Assassins are very interesting. Guardians or Guardian Brothers are very interesting tidbits here.
Yeah, I mean, the Assassins are another part of this coming together of secret societies and organizations. So the Assassins come out of the mystical side of Islam. And so the Assassins are the organizational structure that the Templars are going to bring back to Europe and implement with the Templars and implement with all their other secret societies down the road. So on the surface of Sufism, which is mystical Islam, who the Assassins come from, and there's three different sects of these, and probably a lot of subsects. And again, of course, all of them have different hadiths, so I don't want to go down that line. But anyways, the Assassins worshipped Islam as monotheism on the surface, but underneath and in secrecy, they worshipped polytheism and the pantheon of the gods and practiced the seven liberal arts and the development of that. And just so the audience knows, I don't think science is bad. I think it can be used for good or bad. It's just that what these groups do is they use it for evil. And so this is the organization that the Templars bring back, that on the surface, they are going to appear to be a Catholic order that is, monotheistic. But the adepts, because all of these orders are initiatory orders and you go through different hierarchies of initiation, they worship, Satan as their god, or Baphomet, as some people have quoted about the Templars, which is the same as Azazel, which is part of the seven major watchers who created the Nephilim. But at the end of the day, they all report to Satan. And they followed a manual of discipline and rules, and that was called the Secret Rule of the Order. And in Article 4, it notes, no prince would worship Jesus or bow to him if they knew the secret. And also, from coming from that, they would actually have their initiates spit on the cross. And it says also in Article 4 that only the consoled brothers or the perfecti, which is a Cathar term, which is one of the reasons why you know that they're connected, knew the secret bloodline and the sons of quote unquote New Babylon. And again, when they look at Article 5 out of there, they're talking about organizations and people that they consider important, and they talk about Christians, but that is talking about the Essene Christians that are coming out of Judea, as opposed to the monotheist Christians. Saracens, Jews, because of the Kabbalism that comes out. The Greeks, because of the philosophies. The Romans, for obvious reasons. And the Bulgarians, who are actually the Bogomils, which were the rising of groups like the Manichaeans and the Paulicians and so many of these other groups that were persecuted by the Catholic Church. They actually, in Bulgaria, reestablish in great strength their polytheist religion, and they export that to Western Europe, which become the Cathars and the Albigensians, and those groups start to rival the Catholic Church, which brings on the Inquisition.
Right, and I want to mention too here, and forgive my French, The Plantard release of the Les Dossiers Secrets, there was obviously a big controversy around that.
Yes. Can we
talk, let's talk about that a little bit, too.
Yeah, I mean, they say it's false, that he made it up. But, again, the list is, you know, it's very prestigious. And it only goes back to 1188, right? Not, and that's why I said you want to see that list before it's the Grand Masters out of the Templars. But the big issue is that people say that he made up the Priory of Sion as well, and that there's no historical record to the establishment of the Prior of Sion. And there is historical records to that. And the inside information that, you know, Plantard has, and again, he comes out of the bloodlines as a Plantard, out of, I'm trying to think of his name, is Jalone. And Jalone is the one who sets up, Guillaume de Jalone is his name, who sets up this university where the knowledge is brought back from the excavations that are done under Jerusalem to be translated and put in action under the protection of Saint Bernard again. And so Plantard is heavily connected through bloodlines on that, just as he's connected into the Plantagenet bloodline as well. So he's a very, very important individual. But as I mentioned earlier, Masonic history says that they take their history back to this priory or this small little temple on the Rock of Zion. It's very important to understand that they believe that they take their history back to that. But there are references to the Notre Dame de Sion that's on the Rock of Zion in history. So like in the 12th century, there's a papal bull by Pope Alexander in 1178 that noted the Order of Sion located at Mount Zion in Palestine, that also had other monasteries in Palestine, in Syria, in Italy, and in France. So just as one example. And then there's a French scholar, Emmanuel Ray, who documents talking about the Order of Sion and the Calabrian monks and their connection back in 1888. And this is also... the Calabrian monks are absorbed by the Jesuits in the 1800s. So again, there's a nice, interesting little connection there, mm-hmm. just as a tidbit. And also, you know, King Louis of France mentions a Prior of Sion just outside of, located outside of the city of Orléans. And so this whole understanding of this priory in Jerusalem where King Baldwin is crowned the Duke of the Sepulchre, and in 1118, his brother Baudouin is crowned the King of Jerusalem. This is the beginning of the Templar and the Priory of Sion order, right?
Right.
It goes right back to that history. So you have to put those things together. And that priory remained until about the 1200s when it was destroyed. So it was around for at least 150 years. And this Sion allegory, there's a play on words that goes along with the Priory of Sion. And there's an interesting word that they like to use along with it within the occult circles called Sion, S-C-I-O-N. Mm-hmm. And for people who don't know what that means, it can mean a couple of things. One is it's a young shoot that's cut specifically for grafting in new plants or something, or allegorically a bloodline. And therefore, secondly, it's known as a descendant of a noble, i.e. family or Nephilim family. And also, it's a grafting in of an unknown and hidden or secret origin of a bloodline or plant, because it can be used both ways, which is what Laurie was referring to in the two fathers and the bloodlines out of the sea. And so Sion becomes a code word amongst the Templar adepts and later for the Freemasonry adepts, that they use this interchangeably. And so this whole word Sion and Zion, as they have all of these allegories and metaphors and secret meanings to everything that they do, plays a very, very important role in their understanding.
So again, to sum up here, when we're talking about the Knights Templar, we're talking about the Priory of Sion, we're talking about this ancient knowledge that they have. It may be referring to the seven sacred sciences, but I also believe, and correct me if I'm wrong here, that what they're really protecting was, in fact, this bloodline of the Nephilim, obviously, that came from the Genesis 6 incursion of the fallen angels having sex with human women and creating these offspring, right?
Right, because if you look at the kings of France that are going to intermarry with the Pendragons and the bloodlines coming out of England, and dragon is there for a reason, just as King Arthur was son of Pendragon and was also, you know, war dragon imagery. The bloodlines of that Camelot dynasty and those Pendragons go back to Tuatha De Danann, which are another set of Nephilim. And then you have other Nephilim bloodlines that are coming up through the Sicambian Franks and through the Scythian area as well. So between the kings of France and all of these other Nephilim bloodlines that are being married in, which is part of that Sion allegory of the grafting in of these bloodlines, they're creating a pedigree. The Merovingians believed that they had a pedigree that could not be more ennobled, which included, as I mentioned, they graft in the king of King Saul's bloodlines, because King Saul is a Benjamite, and Benjamites are rewarded Jerusalem by Joshua as their inheritance. So when they're crowning themselves as the king of Jerusalem, which is a title that is still used today, it has a very important meaning to them, and that expect Antichrist will crown himself at the abomination as the king of Jerusalem.
Mm-hmm. Lori?
Okay, so Gary, topic after my own heart here. Okay, I have a question. Okay, you're talking about the grafting in of this bloodline, this Nephilim bloodline, this bloodline of the elite. Are we talking Rh negative here?
Well, when you get into bloodlines, it's a very interesting topic. So a lot of people believe that the royal bloodlines that are coming out of the royal families are all Rh negative bloodlines. And there's a lot to support that. And there's a lot to support that the families of the Northwest France and Southwest France area and Northwest Spain area have high concentrations of Rh negative blood. So Rh negative blood, and just so that people understand, O negative would be the Windsor family. So most of them are O negative. Rh negative is only 15% of the total Earth's bloodline representation. And over 40% of the population in the areas that I was talking about are Rh negative.
Right.
And which is completely higher than the 15%. And out of the vast population, who they call themselves Homo Atlantis and are superior to these bloodlines coming out of the dynasties out of the Middle East to create the dynasties in Europe, because they believe that they go back to the Antediluvian epoch and they spawn the Egyptian civilization, Mesopotamian civilization, and the Scythian civilization, and then settled in Northwest Spain, Southwest France, right at the beginning of the days after the flood. They believe that they are superior, and that's why they were pushed out, and there was sort of infighting between the Basques and the bloodlines coming out of the Middle East. Sorry, I interrupted you there, Laurie.
No, I was going to say, and also, I mean, if you look at the research done on the Rh negative bloodline or the Rh negative blood types, you see that they are significantly different from that of the Rh positive bloodlines. They almost yes. have a reptilian traits, you might say.
Mm-hmm. You know, they certainly don't have the human trait, because they're missing the Rh negative factor blood types are missing the rhesus monkey protein.
Yes.
And even scientists believe that there are two species on this planet, which doesn't make a whole lot of sense unless you understand Genesis 6.
Well, that's where it comes in when he's, you know, grafting in. I immediately thought of that. It's like they are grafting in the Rh negative into the human bloodline, which makes perfect sense.
Yeah, and up to not so long ago, that if you didn't marry a negative and a negative, the negative bloodline would kill the fetus in pregnancy, right?
Absolutely.
And so it's odd, and because when you look at the Rh negative antigen, the D antigen that's missing, if I remember correctly, it's an antigen is something that is supposed to protect the human body. It's not supposed to kill babies, fetuses, right? It's almost like there's a bit of a war going on there, and nobody can explain the insertion of the Rh negative. They know it's not likely originally human. They just don't know when or how it was inserted. They don't want to look at Genesis 6, obviously, at least at this time, until they're ready to bring that out. And when we look at bloodlines, the Rosicrucian understanding of real that the Nazis also participated in is that they believe in there's something in the blood that goes back to the days of Atlantis and the days of the Aryans and the giants, that somehow they could de-engineer backwards and re-forwards again to create giants if they could just understand the DNA sequencing of that a little bit better, let's say, for lack of being a doctor. But they believe, as in Vril, that it comes from the giants before the flood. And there's also this belief called the gene of Isis that you know, Sean had mentioned earlier, you know, first on in the show. And this is a gene that is another marker that comes down through the bloodlines and the genealogies of the parents, and Isis being a mother goddess, right? Or an upgrading of the human females in polytheism that helped create the giants in polytheism. And that it possibly it's this gene that is producing the ability to be missing this antigen, because it's not something added. It's something that is taking away, because it's not there, right? As mm-hmm. as it is in the positive bloodline. And so they believe in the gene of Isis, and they also call that the spark of the divine that goes back to the fallen angels, right? And this is the spark of the divine, or the thousand points of light that they want to collect under one world government and universal religion to cause a vibration, as they like to say in the New Age and mystical religions, or a harmonic convergence to allow them to evolve or vibrate into godhood.
And this is why the elite, the 13 families, keep their bloodlines pure. That's why they interbreed with one another, is to keep this from it losing its power.
Yes, and there's also a hierarchy. The purer the bloodline, the more status you have. Right. And so, and they have to do bring in some outside bloodlines to prevent diseases. And certainly the Habsburgs are an excellent representative of what happens if you intermarry too much with the amount of blood diseases that they had. But yes, they do intermarry and have all the way through. This is a Nephilim trait, because their divine right to rule, as the Stuarts made famous as little gods, as they also like to call themselves, which is again reflective of their whole belief system, comes from the fallen angels as representatives of the gods on earth.
And for the people who don't know about Rh negative factor bloodlines, what we're talking about here is, up until recently, yes, if a mother who was Rh negative actually bore a son, or actually was got pregnant, if they got pregnant and the baby was Rh positive, the mother's body would produce antibodies that would actually kill the child. They have injections and things like now that will stop that. But it's very, very fascinating. It only happens one other place in life, which is between the horse and a donkey. The same type of thing happens there, but those were obviously interbred. And Rh negative factor, I think probably there's something there that's going back to Genesis 6, certainly. I also wanted to ask you too, there's a lot of historical evidence that says the Knights Templar were Palestinians. In fact, that they were fluent in Arabic language. And does that have anything to do with what we see going on with Israel and Palestine now?
Not sure I understand the question.
Well, I just see what's going on over in Palestine. And if the Knights Templar were Palestinians, yeah, I mean, are we talking about an age-old war here?
Right. Well, I mean, they did bring in Palestinians for the, you know, communication and the language, right? They would communicate for them. But the Palestinians are the Philistines.
Mm-hmm.
As they go back into history. And, of course, you know, the Philistines were blood enemies of Israel. Even in David's time, even though he defeated the Philistines many times, they never wiped them off. And the Philistines were inundated with the Avim, as you might recall, which are a kind of Rephaim, right? And the Rephaim and the Anakim are the two main names that come out of the Bible for the giants. And there's many other ones like, you know, Avim and Emin and Zamzuzim and Emin and on and on and on. They all descend back to the Nephilim. And so there's an ongoing hatred there. And also the Philistines come from the island of Crete and their history, and I'll talk a little bit about it in my book, as a possibility that also goes antediluvian as well.
Mm-hmm. And also then on the Knights Templar were basically dismantled in about 1307. There was the Priory of Sion actually said, you know, wait a minute, they parted ways through a thing called the cutting of the elm in Normandy. Yep. And I want to talk a little bit about that on the other side of the break. It's a fascinating discussion. We're getting into a lot of historical evidence here. Again, the book is The Genesis 6 Conspiracy by Gary Wayne, How Secret Societies and the Descendants of Giants Plan to Enslave Humankind. Highly recommend the book if you're into this historical research. It's a fascinating read, and I love the way the book is put together because you have you can grab a couple chapters and read a couple chapters, and because it's a 1,000-page-plus book, but you can read these chapters as like little mini stories. So again, The Genesis 6 Conspiracy by Gary Wayne. We will be right back after this short break in just about 3 minutes. Also, my co-host Laurie Alexander, thank you both for joining me today. Stay tuned, everyone.
RTFR.
My faith in destiny is all I need to prevail.
Truth Frequency Radio.
I'll bust it one time. Truth and liberty. Fighting the new world order and the tyranny. The Awakening Liberty Show with Sean Carone.
And we are back. Final segment of the Awakening Liberty Show right here on Truth Frequency Radio. My guest, Gary Wayne, my co-host, Laurie Alexander, talking about the Genesis 6 conspiracy, how secret societies and the descendants of giants plan to enslave humankind. It is a historical romp. And boy, every time I get into this book, my head starts spinning and I start going to all kinds of other things, the concordance and the Bible, and trying to make heads or tails of what's really going on in the world. And sometimes when I'm in this book, I mean, it's like, wow, words are eluding me today because there's so much information. But take your time, get the book, and definitely check it out. And also, I want to mention on Awakening Liberty Show channel on YouTube, you can listen to parts 1 through 5 now. Today will be part 6, and it will be up tomorrow on YouTube. There's an entire playlist of all the shows Gary and I have done. We've talked about Freemasonry, the Illuminati, Anatomy of a Global Conspiracy, the Blackheads of Nippur, the Race of Day 6, the House of Dragon, and all the Antichrist bloodlines with Gary Wayne. So check it out at Awakening Liberty Show on YouTube. You can check them all out. And this one will be up by tomorrow as well. Before the break, we were talking about the cutting of the elm, and this is where the Knights Templar and the Priory of Sion broke company. I mean, was there a falling out? What happened here?
Yeah, so they felt that the Knights Templar were too focused on acquisition of wealth and acquisition of power and banking and all the different things that the Templars were doing over the original priority. And as you mentioned earlier, they wanted to put their king on the French throne and then the king, you know, the world down the road. And they wanted to put a descendant of the Merovingian and Jesus and Mary Magdalene on that throne of the world, and they're dedicated to keeping the secret, or the scion of the bloodlines, and keeping that secret, and then also to protect the children of the bloodline and to protect the secret. So these are the things that they were trying to protect, because they believe that their future Antichrist, which they sometimes refer to as the Grand Monarch, who will make his appearance at Geyser Castle, at the Governor's Tower that forms the main entrance to the town on the street called the Grand Monarch. And the reason why I bring that up, and just to connect some dots, is the cutting of the elms happens at Geyser Castle, where these two organizations split away. And what's interesting is at Geyser Castle, after the splitting of the way, you have two different organizations with different Grand Masters, which is why the Priory of Sion Grand Master list begins in 1188. And this is when the Rose Cross Order is set up by John Geyser as well, which will help bring about the setup of all the other secret societies after the fall of the Knights Templar. And the Rosicrucians are kind of that intersection between the pure bloods and the families and the lower secret societies as we know it today, and are kind of represented with about half at the top of pure bloods in the Rosicrucian order. And what's also interesting is that the first Grand Master is none other than Marie Sinclair, right? Or Sinclair. And these are the same ones that are going to protect the Templars after the fall in England and convert them over to Freemasonry. And she's married to John Geyser. So again, no coincidence there. But I also want to take this connection back a little bit further, right to the founding of the Knights Templar. You have Hugh de Payen, who I didn't really spend any time on, who is the second most recognized individual other than Godfrey de Bouillon of Boulogne. And he is the son-in-law of Saint Bernard, who married into the Sinclair family, or the Sinclair family as they're known back there. And so the first Grand Master is a Sinclair. And then you have, after that, you have William de Geyser, and you have all of these royal bloodlines that are running the Prior of Sion before it moves over to the scientists after the creation, basically, of the Royal Society. And you even have a few other St. Clairs, like Jean de St. Clair in 1350 or so, as I recall, as also being one of the Grand Masters. And when we talk about the cutting of the elm ceremony, this is a Gnostic ceremony. And if you look at the word, French word for elm, it's orme. Just as the Knights Templar did most of their business under a great elm tree in the city of Paris, because the elm tree is a very high level of significance in Gnosticism. And it goes back to Ormus of Alexandria, or that one of those other groups that we're talking about that came together to form the Knights Templar. And St. Mark is one of the leaders that they like to say converted from the Alexandrian Gnostics, but likely he was another mole within the church. But what's interesting about this Orme and Ormus relationship, this is the same transliteration that's coming down from another Gnostic or polytheist sect known as the Zoroastrians, which takes its religions right back to the Aryans and right back into prehistory. And of course, the Aryans are the ones who set up the Hindu religion after the flood. And the connection of the transliteration goes back to Ormuzd or Ahur Mazda, which is the ancient Persian Mazda in the ancient Persian Mazdaean tradition. And that is a serpent symbol for their god, Ahur Mazda. So all of this stuff has very important imagery and names and setting when they do anything. And to do this with the cutting of an elm, because they chopped down the elm tree, was a significant allegory of a splitting of this organization over issues.
It's very interesting stuff. And again, the rabbit hole is deep, and there's so much symbology and all kinds of things going on here that we all need to be paying attention to. And I'm just going to kind of sum this up in my head, and correct me if I'm wrong. The secret that the Gnostics and the mystics and the Knights Templar and the Priory of Sion, really the secret that they are protecting and have been protecting for centuries, eons at this point, is the fact that they are descendants of the Nephilim.
Yes.
There you have it, folks. That sums it up. And in fact, that's why his book is The Genesis 6 Conspiracy, How Secret Societies and the Descendants of Giants Plan to Enslave Humankind. That's who these people are. That's who's running the world. That's who the 13 families are. That's who the Illuminati is. That's who the upper echelon of the elite wacko sycophants out there in the world today. They are the descendants of these, and that is the secret they are protecting. And they don't want us Christians. They want us to come away from God. They want us to come away from the fact that Jesus Christ did what he did for us.
Yeah, and you see glimpses of this. You know, I mentioned the folk of Anjou, who is one of the main named founders of the Templars as well, you know, amongst the main 9 or 11, depending which tradition you want to use. Well, I mean, this is the family that produces the Plantagenet, which produces King John and King Richard, which most of the presidents, I think all but Obama, and who knows, he may take his bloodlines back elsewhere, but take their bloodlines back to the Plantagenet. You have Prince Charles on record of saying that he takes his bloodlines back to Vlad the Impaler, mm-hmm. right? And of the Sarkani Rond and the Ordo Draconis, which is set up after the fall of the Knights, not the fall of the Knights Templar, after the splitting of the Elm and the Prior of Sion splitting away. One of the first things that they do on the Rosicrucian establishment is they set up this organization that is going to initiate Vlad the Impaler and his son and his father into this order called the Ordo Draconis. And this is the individual that, you know, Dracula is based on. And it's that second sort of fold allegory of what these giants looked like. And they're connecting all of these bloodlines back because Vlad the Impaler had red hair as opposed to blonde hair and hazel eyes as opposed to blue eyes, because those are the two color distinctions in the Nephilim in ancient history. And here you have an archetypical description with Vlad the Impaler, who drinks blood like the Nephilim did to extend his life and increase his cognitive ability, who is called Dracula, which it means son of Dracul, which is a dragon. And with a vampire, you have basically the dragon sort of bloodline that I've been talking about and drinking blood. And they are the opposite, not the opposite, but the arch enemy of Christians. I mean, the allegory is absolutely intense.
Mm-hmm. And it's all right there in front of us if we're paying attention. I'd like to bring Laurie in here because we were talking a little bit about the scientists and some of the grand masters of the Priory of Sion. And we're actually talking about some of the one notables are Isaac Newton. We also have Leonardo da Vinci. I want to talk about Isaac Newton a little bit. And I wonder if Laurie's got any questions about Isaac Newton and his whole gravity thing.
You know, it doesn't surprise me that these scientists have deep-seated roots in the secret societies because of the fact that, you know, they use science as their god, per se. So, I don't have anything to say about Isaac Newton and his gravity thing. I think that's a whole other show. But I just find it interesting that Stephen Hawking holds the same chair at Cambridge that Isaac Newton did. I just find that very interesting.
Yeah, and Isaac Newton was also president of the Royal Society, right?
Mm. Yeah.
Gnosticism was also one of these masters also, correct?
Pardon me?
Nostradamus was also one of these grand masters too, correct?
I don't have Nostradamus listed as a grand master in my research, but that doesn't mean I have a complete list here. So, but what he was a Rosicrucian. And I mean, we're talking about Rosicrucians that are running the Priory of Sion. So he was certainly intimately connected with all of these different individuals. But no, I don't seem to see him on my list. So.
Yeah, he's not. The reason I mentioned Isaac Newton was because both Laurie and I are flat. We've, you know, we're looking at the firmament. We're looking at the idea that this whole globe thing, this whole gravity thing, this whole NASA deception is part of this. This whole agenda of trying to dismantle God, dismantle the special nature of humanity and where we live. You know, I don't know if the world is flat, but I'll tell you what, I don't see any evidence that it's really a spinning ball in space either. And Isaac Newton is the father of gravity, which the whole heliocentric model is based on.
Yeah. And when you consider that science is not this objective, consider all sides of the debate organization, and that it's linked back to polytheism with a polytheist belief system to lead people away from God, it's hard to trust what they're saying. And it's hard to know what is fact from fiction, because they do a very good job of sort of intermingling that. So I think when we look at what science is telling us today, we have to question everything, because they are working towards an agenda. And I think that not all of the scientists know it, but I mean, you only get funded in science today, and probably all along, if you were going to give a preconceived or preconcluded decision as to what your research was looking for. Otherwise, you don't get the money for it. And if you come along with a different idea, I mean, you're persecuted right out of the scientific community. So this is not cold secular objectivity. This is part of the brainwashing, and that's why all the organizations still report back in science to the Royal Society today. And the Smithsonian is the American sort of wing, I suppose, in a lot of different aspects. But, you know, Smithson was a member of the Royal Society and a Rosicrucian and a Freemason.
Yeah, when you start looking at who these people are and who they were, I mean, they were cohorting with some of the most evil, probably wacko people in the world, and all these secret societies. It's just you got to connect the dots, and then you really have to start questioning everything. Gary, I want to ask you, have you seen Del Tekitz's Genesis History yet?
No, I haven't.
Oh, you got to see the movie. It's absolutely fascinating. It completely destroys the old Earth paradigm and really looks at obviously antediluvian and the flood and everything, and really proves its existence with a great panel of PhDs. I highly recommend it. It's available on Netflix. I've seen the movie 3 times already, and I got to keep going back for more because it's absolutely amazing.
Wow. I'll have to see it.
Yeah, it's definitely on Netflix. So let's talk a little bit more about who these people were at the top of the Priory of Sion. And I guess my first question is the Priory of Sion still around, and do they have a Grand Master now? Do we know who they are?
Well, we don't know who the leader is after Plantard, and they're going to keep it that way. But yeah, they're still around, but it's in that sort of upper echelon of the bloodlines, and they're going to keep that as secret as possible. You know, their goal is to bring about the universal religion and the world government and to present their Antichrist. So yes, they are definitely still around, and they're controlling, you know, the organizations through the Rosicrucians. So they're still around.
If you had to make a guess or some possibilities of who the Grand Master might be now, would you have any idea?
No idea. No.
Laurie?
I just have a question regarding that aspect of it. Black Pope, could he possibly be the leader of it? Because I found something quite interesting recently. Doing my research, I found that there's been a switch in leadership with both the Opus Dei aspect of it and also the Black Pope. We saw Nicholas Adolfo being replaced by Father Arturo Sosa, and we saw Opus Dei now has Monsignor Fernando Azores as leader. So we saw recently a change in leadership in both, almost at the same time, or right around the same time.
Yeah, it certainly it's a possibility. I can't say I would have anything on that, but what I do know is the Jesuits. Just so that people understand, is that they do have a close association with the secret societies, but parted company with the Masonic organization because the Jesuits wanted to take over and control Freemasonry, and they have their own agendas, as I mentioned. So they work their own agendas working into the same directions. So there is that cross-pollination through their history and focusing on what they're doing today. And you'd certainly look at France's consolidating power today under Jesuit control and getting and changing doctrine. And if you go back to connect another dot to connect where I'm going here, is Francis Bacon, who wrote the book The New Atlantis, talked about in the end time in The New Atlantis that you would have a religion that would work with harmony with science. And of course, it's the polytheistic religion of mysticism that would work with science. And of course, it's the Rosicrucians who created theosophy, which produced New Age down the road, which was designed as a bridge to bring polytheism and the sciences together. And of course, Francis Bacon is the inspirational founder for the Royal Society, and his picture is one of three that hangs in the main entrance even to this day as the inspirational founder. And so you see that where I'm going with this, if you follow what I'm saying, is there has to be a convergence of religion and science in the end time. So when you look at what Francis is doing and how political he's becoming and how he's looking at the environment and everything else, that could possibly be coming together there. But that's the only connections I can draw.
Well, yeah, and he seems to be, he wants to be all-inclusive with many of the world religions, which again is leading us down this road of this one world religion. And then we see Christians being persecuted everywhere.
Well, as the prophecies, the Catholic prophecies of the priest Malachi in the 1200s, who listed out all of the popes to the end time, there's a bit of dispute that some people think there's one more pope to come, but he laid out the complete order and gave clues as to how they would be identified. And most people would, you know, who read about it say he's pretty much bang on. And with this one, for the timing that we're in right now to replace Benedict, I mean, he called him the anti-pope and the black pope. Well, we already talked about the black pope is the leader of the Jesuits. So the first time we have a leader of the Jesuits as a black pope, and most people were expecting a black skin pope, let's say out of Africa or the U.S., to become pope. But it's an allegory for the leader of the Jesuit society, which is, again, that secret part of this secret societies we've been talking about as an initiatory organization only within Catholicism. And if you look at the word Antichrist and take that back to its Greek meaning, it can mean either sort of opposing or opposite of Christ or replacement Christ. So if you use that term with anti-pope, you have replacement pope. Well, one of the few times in history we actually have two popes. I think 1600 was the last time in around one of the Pope Gregory's, as I recall. And so Benedict was replaced by Francis. So he's anti-pope and the black pope. So he's the one that is supposed to lead the world astray through Catholicism to make the way for the false prophet and prepare for the universal religion. So if that is true, and I understand that that's not canon, then it would make sense that he is bringing in and maybe leading the scientific organization, as well as, you know, I think everybody knows he's pretty much from a socialistic policy, as Jesuits are, which will be the type of government we get in the end time will be a socialism.
Mm-hmm. It's very interesting. And here we have a pope that used to be a bouncer in a bar. I mean, he's the most unlikely pope I could ever see. But obviously, when we talk about the Jesuits, they are a very strange organization.
Oh, very, very strange. And as I said, they, you know, they were created by Ignatius of Loyola, as I recall. And he's also, you know, had a vision of Mary. And I'll write about Mary in the book and the visions as part of what I think is that thing that's going to help take over the Catholic Church, which will spread to the rest of the world as this universal religion comes about. But the Jesuits interpret the Bible through the philosophies of the seven sacred sciences. I mean, it is, he's going to change doctrine in unbelievable ways, and he's already started.
Yeah, and it's happening over and over. And yes, the current Pope was a bouncer in a bar. That's what he used to do. He was not a nice man before he came to the cloth, from what I understand of his history. And, you know, I was schooled by the Jesuits, Gary, and I was schooled so well that I actually, in hindsight, I look back and I'm like, the education I received from the Jesuits is exactly what pushed me away from God, my faith, and Christ for a very, very long time.
Wow. Wow.
I mean, you know, and there I am in Sister Mary Peter's class going, hello, who are these sons of God? What is this story in Genesis 6? And I keep getting sent to the dean's office. And they wouldn't give me an answer.
Yep. I'm Jesuit trained to Catholic schools from kindergarten to 11th grade. Absolutely.
The major deception. I mean, and, you know, I love my Catholic brothers and sisters, but so many of them I do really believe are being deceived.
Yeah, well, and that's their job, right? We talked about that. That's one of the things that they were designed to do. And, you know, after the fall of the Templars, I mean, you had to have some other organizations created, and they wanted to make sure things were going to be decentralized so it couldn't be so easily taken apart as what the Pope and the King of France did, likely more through greed than anything else. But, you know, you had Freemasonry that were set up in the 1300s, and their focus was on politics and the military in a preparatory organization. And now they also have the media. The Rosicrucians were set up to maintain the old religion and create the cosmology in the New Babylon, focusing on development of the sciences and alchemy, which is why they partnered with Freemasonry to create the Royal Society to develop the what they call the absolute science. And that's, of course, the next organization of the Royal Society to, we already covered them off, to lead people away and to control education and to manipulate scientific advancement to their own goal. You have the Illuminati, that's job is to destroy Christianity, right, and to focus on world government. And you have the Jesuits who, you know, are the moles and the front and center in Catholic doctrine now, and to also control the education within the Catholicism and eventually take it over, which they're in a position to do today. And then you had the Rothschilds that were set up out of the Bauer family out of Germany to as the banking arm, because the Templars were, you know, the first modern bankers.
And right, they were.
Controlled, you know, they invented things like checks and deposits and things like that, and they indebted all of the kings and the queens and funded their wars and then manipulated them through the power they had over the debt to do what they wanted them to do, just as what these organizations like the banks do today and the World Monetary Fund and the World Bank. They indebt countries so that they can control them.
And we're running out of time here, but I just want to read one of the passages in your epilogue. I do not believe this book or any other or known Christian organization can prevent the relentless procession of juggernauts destined for global occupation. In fact, I do not believe this book will in any way stall the descendants of giants and their powerful array of secret societies march to global occupation. They are too entrenched, too well-financed, and too well-organized. It is essentially a fait accompli, projected to be completed shortly on their predetermined timetable. All has been preordained by God Most High to succeed for a short time in the not so distant future. I think that sums it all up, folks. Find God, come to God, pray, realize that there is a very, very secret and nefarious, spurious force on this planet who's in league with Satan. I want to thank you, Gary and Laurie, for joining me today.
Well, hello? Thank you for having me.
Yeah, most definitely. Laurie, thanks for being my co-host again today. We'll do it again soon.
It was my pleasure. Can't wait. See you soon.
All right, everybody. Tune in next week. Laurel Austin will be on the show talking about vaccines, 2 p.m. Pacific time Saturday. Thank you so much. God bless everyone.